All right, do we want to go ahead and get started?
Good. Hello, I am Rose. I am one of the co-chairs for We in Space and project manager with the Portland State Aerospace Society. So welcome to our Aerospace Fellowship info session. So We in Space is an inclusive and diverse environment for women, gender minorities that are interested in the space industry. And PSAS is Portland State Aerospace Society, and we build rockets, satellites, and liquid fuel engines. So with that, I will pass it off to, let's see, who's going first, Catie?
I think so.
Let's see. Okay.
Hi everyone. So today we're gonna talk about, I think, five of the different aerospace fellowships that are available for students. So we're going to start with Matthew Isakowitz, then Brooke Owens, Patti Grace Smith, Zed Factor, and Zenith Canada. And I'm Catie. I was a 2021 Brooke Owens Fellow. I graduated from Portland State with my bachelor's in mechanical engineering in 2021, and then my master's in mechanical engineering in 2022. And my pronouns are she, her.
Hi, my name is Teresa. I use they, them pronouns. I am one of the most recent Brooke Owens Fellows, so fresh off of my internship this past summer. I am majoring in electrical engineering and part of Portland State University's Bridge program. So that just basically means I'm fast tracking into the master's program.
Hello, everyone. My name is Megan Jordan. I'm an aerospace engineering student at the University of Alabama in Huntsville. I was a Patti Grace Smith Fellow for the 2021 academic year, and then a Brooke Owens Fellow this past summer.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ryan Udell. I'm one of the Zed Factor founding partners. Say where I went to school. I received a bachelor's in mechanical engineering from Rice University, currently pursuing a master's of electrical engineering at Stanford and working for Boeing as a systems engineer.
Awesome. We will be covering the different fellowships, and then at the end we have some questions prepared, and then we'll also have Q&A time that I'm going to kind of flip through. And you can also put questions down in the chat as well. So we are going to start with the Matthew Isakowitz Fellowship. And this program was created in memory of Matthew Isakowitz, and you can read a little bit about him here and also on the website, but essentially he inspired a lot of people in the industry, and he unfortunately passed away, and so some of his friends and family started a fellowship in his honor. And this fellowship, as well as the others, follow kind of a similar structure. And my cat is trying to break out of the bedroom, so if you hear strange noises, that's my cat. So the Matthew Isakowitz Fellowship offers an internship in the industry, a summit in which all of the fellows of that year get together, and mentorship and networking opportunities. Again, I was a Brooke Owens Fellow, so I'm not super familiar with this program, but I think it follows a very similar structure. In terms of application requirements, in order to be eligible, you do need to be a junior or up. So that's going to be within your second to last or last year in college, if you are a super senior or something like that. But I believe they also, they take graduate students as well, interested in commercial space flight. And you also need to have earned a degree or is working towards earning one in engineering or science. So that's very specific, and you'll see some differences in these eligibility requirements throughout the fellowships. Also, having diversity in experience and academic interests. So if you have the engineering degree or you're working towards it, but you also have interest and experience in business and other things that are related to commercial space, you do need to be a US citizen or a US permanent resident. And this is really because of the companies in the aerospace industry have these requirements. The application is due October 14th, so coming up soon, and you'll need the completed application, a resume, transcript, three essays, my dog is also sneezing, and two letters of recommendation. And you can also see all of this on the website, which maybe I will link when we go to the next fellowship as well.
Okay, so the Brooke Owens Fellowship, a fellowship that three out of the four folks hosting this evening have been through. Originally, the Brooke Owens Fellowship was, next slide, please. Thank you. History of the Brooke Owens Fellowship was created to honor Dawn Brooke Owens and designed to boost women and gender minorities into the aerospace field, matching them with handpicked mentors and a paid internship. And that's they also specify that it's a living wage paid internship. So when you're out there, you can both like be comfortable with where you're staying and then also like be able to do your job. So they offer a variety of things. So we've paid internships, as was mentioned, executive mentorship, which basically means that you have someone professionally actively working in the space industry who is hand-selected and paired with you, as well as professional development and networking mentorship. And so you also get a Brooke Owens alum mentor as well, so someone who's already been through it and has also a similar background to you as well. And then they work to very carefully pair you with that. And then also every summer there is a Brooke Owens summit, usually held in DC. During COVID, it was held remotely, but I was able to go to the first back in-person session in DC this past summer. So application requirements. This one is a little more unique than some of the other technical aerospace fellowships I've seen, at least in my experience when I was reading through. So they have your usuals like resume, transcript, two letters of recommendation. And then when you get into the original works that you're submitting a written portion and a multimedia portion. So that could be a video, it could be poetry, it could be an illustration, it could be a poster, whatever you want to have happen. And then over on the right of the slide, you'll see that the process goes through your submission. They review your application thoroughly. There's semi-finalist interviews, and then host interviews, and then final match, and then final selection. This all happens like very quickly once they get back to you and say, all right, you're in. And so you kind of have to like stay on top of your messages a little bit because they rapid fire, like once you're in, it's pretty bonkers, but also super fun in a weird way. Due date coming up is on October 10th for this one. Didn't mean to cut off. I just realized that there wasn't the eligibility thing that was listed in that slide. That was my error. But to add for eligibility, another thing that's really lovely about this fellowship is that they also welcome international students. I believe this past cohort had the largest group of international students who came through as Brooke Owens Fellowship. And so they really try to push through on that because I know that some students who are interested in aerospace, especially if they wanted to work in the US, will usually come up on needing to either have a green card or a US citizenship. So Brooke Owens welcomes that, just as a heads up. And you can be in any year in your undergrad. Okay, I'm done.
All right, so sorry for interrupting. I got a little excited. So again, my name is Megan, and I'm presenting Patti Grace Smith Fellowship. We can go to the next slide, please. So a little bit about our history. We were founded in 2020 in honor of Patti Grace Smith, who was an aerospace industry leader. She also overcame a system of legalized racial segregation, being one of the first students to actually integrate Tuskegee High School in Tuskegee, Alabama. Overcoming all of this, she became a remarkable aerospace leader. And one of her most notable experiences was running the Federal Aviation Administration Office of Commercial Space Transportation. And when she was running that, she actually certified Mojave to be an air and spaceport, which I think is super cool. I like to say that she's the reason that we're able to have like personal and commercial space travel. So really, really cool. We can go to the next slide, please. So what exactly is the Patti Grace Smith Fellowship? It's a program that connects Black undergraduate students with internships and mentorship in the aerospace industry. Who is the fellowship open to? We're open to Black or African-American students. You must be a US citizen or US permanent resident. Now we're open to students in any year of their undergraduate education, and you must be seeking your first ever job or internship in the aerospace industry. So we're open to any gender, any major, any GPA, any college, whether that's a community college or a four-year university. Next slide, please. So what does the Patti Grace Smith Fellowship offer? So paid internships at leading aerospace companies. Fellows are matched with a 12-week internship where they will be paid a living wage for the summer. Also executive mentorship, like the other fellowships, fellows are matched with executive mentors and also a near peer mentor. Patti Grace Smith Fellows are also given a scholarship. I'm not sure what the amount is this year, but that's another perk of the Patti Grace Smith Fellowship. And then also an annual summit where everyone comes together in Washington, D.C. So you get to meet all of the other fellows who are in your current class and also meet really cool people like CEOs, astronauts, and all types of aerospace industry leaders. So just a really, really exciting experience to be a part of. And it's definitely been one of the, like, my most favorable parts of my career so far. And then another perk is also being a Patti for life. So you're not just a part of this network for the year that you're in the fellowship. The idea is that you're in it for life and you're connected with these people for life. So I like to say that I have like a group of like 42 other students. And then for Brookies, I have a group of 52 other people who are just as passionate about the things that I'm passionate about. And if you want to learn more, you can learn more at ptsfellowship.org/apply. And then this is also the handle to all of our social media. So some application requirements. So for phase one, to submit your application, you just need a current resume and a transcript. Unofficial transcripts are happily accepted. You need two recommendation letters, whether that be from literally like your best friend. I know one of my friends wrote mine. It can be a professor or a high school teacher if you're just like a freshman in college. And then also you'll need a multimedia video submission. So then if you move on from phase one to phase two, you interview with host companies. Some of our host companies, just to give a few examples, are Blue Origin, Hermes, Airbus, NASA Goddard. So some really, really big notable aerospace companies. And then after you interview with those host companies, we move on to phase three. You're actually matched with them. So that means you're a fellow. So congratulations. To join this class of 2023 fellows, the deadline is October 23rd. So if you know anyone who is eligible for the fellowship, please let them know that the deadline is quickly approaching. That's all.
All righty. Okay, so hello everyone. Ryan Udell again here to present about the Zed Factor Fellowship. So please go to the next slide. So the Zed Factor Fellowship was founded in 2020 in an effort to be more inclusive in the aerospace industry. And we are really held up by two pillars, not just internships, but also community engagement projects to help undergraduate students from underrepresented backgrounds engage in aerospace. And the best part about our fellowship is that underrepresented is self-defined. So if you don't feel like there's a place for you in the industry, or you feel like you're having trouble getting in, tell us about it. And that's how it's defined. It's really based on you, and we don't try to limit that in any way. It is open to only undergraduate students who have 30 plus credit hours, which puts you as a sophomore in terms of most fellowships. However, we have many freshmen apply who have AP credit, IB credit, and other things that also count towards the program. So it's any college credit, dual enrollment, anything you've had counts towards that. And therefore, we've had many first year, second year, third year, fourth year, and fifth year students in this program. Also, you can apply even if you're graduating in December of this year, So it's open for as long as you are in school during the application period. Even if you graduate before the application period ends, then you are able to apply. We have a 3-month application window, which will be opening shortly. Next slide, please. So we have 5 key pillars of the Zed Factor Fellowship. The first one is listed here is what you've seen before and heard before. It's mentorship from an aerospace professional. We pair you with an executive mentor who aligns closely to your technical field, and a near peer mentor who aligns more closely to your interests, whether it's like grad school, industry, and like what field. We provide an immersive internship at an aerospace company. We are open to all majors and anyone eligible to work in the US. So that includes international students. We may be open to fully international students this year, but that's still to be determined. We have a professional development programming throughout the fellowship, as well as a flagship leadership summit that happens in Washington, DC. It's a great place to meet all the Zed Factor fellows, as well as discuss your community engagement projects, learn about technical skills, non-technical skills, policy, industry leaders, and it summarizes itself as the ending event in coordination with future space leaders programming. One of the biggest things that we offer is, and one of the coolest things that we offer is a self-designed community engagement project. So this project can be anything from developing the first Nepal space conference, which we've had done before, developing mentorship programs to help students from your community get into college. We've had art projects, we've had history projects, we've had thrust vector control rocket projects. So really anything that you think will help make an impact in a community that's most meaningful to you, that's what we're looking for. These projects have already impacted over 3,500 people directly and over 10,000 people more indirectly. And so it's a really powerful tool to use the resources you were given and then give that to the community that most interests you. And then lastly, you have a lasting network. You will always be a ZI once you are a Zed Factor Fellow, and that will continue to help you throughout your entire rest of your education as well as the rest of your life. Next slide, please. So application requirements are listed here. They are subject to change until we release the application, most likely in the next month, because we do like to give one of the longest application periods for people to work on it, as well as understanding that starting school right now either starting a new semester is tough, as well as we believe that the current cycle of job cycle is too many people think if you don't get a job by November or an internship by November, you're out of luck. That's not the case. All of our fellows are placed in the spring because our applications are due in early January. But typically for application requirements, we require a resume and transcript, and then we require 3 essays, one of which is a choice between three essays, and then there's 2 required essays. And then in the past, we've had 2 letters of recommendation that are optional. This may change in the future to something else. We recognize that while it's great to have someone speak for you, we know that not everyone can put their best foot forward in letters of recommendation, and thus we want to hear you and know from your essays the most. We look at applications very holistically. So GPA isn't everything. We've had everyone from under a 2.0 GPA get this fellowship to over 4.0. So very, very broad range. So that's more of your GPA and transcript is more of a formality for us to confirm the 30 plus credit hours. And if there are other documentation you must submit, please just attach it in one single PDF to your transcript to show that you meet that requirement. So again, until the official 2023 application is announced. All this is subject to change, but in general, most of it will stay the same. Next slide. I think that's it. All right, thanks so much. Please apply once it comes out. We have an amazing array of host companies, more to be added this year. And we have 100% success rate in internships and job opportunities after the fellowship. So hope, please feel free to ask any questions or ask on our website by going to zedfactorfellowship.org. Thanks.
All right. And last but certainly not least, we have the Zenith Fellowship. Next slide, please. So the Zenith Fellowship is brand new. It's founded in 2021. One of our co-founders is actually also a Brookie from, I think, 1 or 2 years ago. And its mission is to provide internship mentorship opportunities to support and sustain talent in Canada with a focus on underrepresented and disadvantaged groups. So this is following in the footsteps of the amazing fellowships in the US, and it is the first of its kind in Canada. So what they offer is a Canadian mentor from within the vibrant space community, a paid position at a space company in Canada, and the opportunity to work on projects that are out of this world during the summer of 2023. There's participation at the annual professional development summit where you can meet mentors, host companies, and go with your class of fellows. And the community of people within the Canadian space community will help you with the next steps of your career. So application requirements, and we can post links to the websites to all of the fellowships later on as well. It looks like they also have an applicant Discord. You can visit their website to get a hold of all the information that is involved. Standard formalities, resume, unofficial transcript, proof of graduation. So this one is limited to recent graduates only. Resume no longer than 2 pages max, so 1 to 2 pages. Two references can be contacted to confirm participation in the experiences that you have mentioned. So whatever you have on your resume, be sure you can speak to it. Two original works, so covering the areas of professional and community interest and experience. You submit one long form essay and one multimedia essay. So a little bit similar to how the Brooke Owens Fellowship will ask you to submit personal information about yourself. And then there'll be a short prompt to tell you what EDI means to you. And this is specifically open to Canadian citizens, permanent residents, or a person who has been granted refugee status in Canada. So if this applies to you or you know someone who it could apply to, and they are interested in joining the space industry, please, please pass this along. And the due date for this one is October 5th.
Awesome. Okay. So we are going to do a panel, but first I wanted to see if anybody had questions, and then also just putting a disclaimer in because I have to for work, but our views are our own and do not necessarily represent that of the companies that we currently work for, have worked for, or the fellowships that we were fellows in. Yeah. So anyways,
except
for you, because it does represent you. does anyone have questions right off the bat? Is the Brooke Owens Fellowship open to graduate students? I believe it is undergrad, but I applied in my senior year, so I was technically going into graduate school after that, but I don't think that's a requirement. So if you're a senior, you can still apply, but if you are a graduate student already, then it's not open.
The only fellowship open to graduate students is the Matthew Isakowitz Fellowship.
Yeah, thank you.
Yep. If you are a current graduate.
Is there advice you can give for the video submission portions of the applications? I don't know which specific fellowship this is in regards to.
Well, if you don't like videos, you can always apply to the Zed Factor Fellowship. We don't have that, so.
Well, and then also, I'm wondering if maybe it might be assumed that it's only video, but are you referring to the multimedia application, Alan? Like the multimedia portion of the application, excuse me.
Yes, that portion. I know that 2 or 3 out of the 5 fellowships do have that as a requirement. And
yeah.
I was hoping to get pretty generalized advice as to anything that would be useful before submitting those, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. So to that end, a video, you could do a video if that's what you wanted to do. That is absolutely like not a requirement that it specifically needs to be one. But if you were to choose that venue, let's see, because I know Brooke Owens also has specific rules around what you can and cannot share for what those multimedia submissions are. So best way I can phrase that is it's just another visual way to share something about yourself that like you wouldn't find in a resume, that you wouldn't find in a cover letter. Because what folks are looking for is something that's a little bit more than just, here's what I have accomplished, A, B, C, D, here are all the extracurriculars I've done, here's this and this. It's like, what else can we know about Alan beyond Alan's accomplishments? That's my understanding of like what the multimedia portion is trying to get at. Does that help answer your question a little bit?
Yes, it does. Thank you so much.
Absolutely.
And I would add to that just real quickly, think about what you want to say and then think about how you want to say it. That's the approach that I took because I figured once I knew what story I wanted to convey, it was a little bit easier to think about the different ways to do that best. Next question, are any of the fellowships open to post-bac students? I know that, I don't want to say I know, but I believe that many Brooke Owens fellows were returning for a second degree, which could be considered post-bac. So at least Brooke Owens is, because you're still currently in undergraduate school, whether that's your first or second time, I think doesn't matter.
Yeah, I'm a post-bac and I was able to get welcomed into it and do great. I think as long as you were specifically identified as an undergrad, like it's chill.
That's same with the Zed Factor Fellowship.
So much in chat. Would it be acceptable for a transferring junior to have a professor from their previous institution write their letter of recommendation? I'm going to say yes, but other people can expand on that.
Yeah, I would think so. I've definitely consulted folks with institutions I'm no longer with, or like I have a background in grassroots organizing. And so like I would talk with old colleagues and say, hey, can you write this letter? Because you know this side of me that isn't necessarily strictly academic and that can give a little more dimension to you as an applicant. So yeah.
All right. Oh, okay. Perfect. I love when there's questions. Okay. I'm currently in MECOP. MECOP is PSU, but I think some other schools do it too. And working towards my capstone based on level of participation in the fellowships, which one would you recommend or not? Andrew, are you at PSU? Yes. Okay. Let's see, I can say personally, I chose not to do MECOP because I knew that I wanted to go into the aerospace industry and the MECOP options, I think Boeing might've been one of the only ones, and then you don't get to choose. And so I didn't want to like risk that personally. And then based on the level of participation, I would say, yeah, it really just depends on what you're trying to get out of it. Like for me, I knew aerospace. And so I worked at United Launch Alliance working on rockets, which was like my main goal. But if you're really looking to like really work for a full year in whatever industries that you might get through MECOP, then it really just depends again on what is interesting to you.
Okay, yeah, because can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, because that was my concern, right, is because I don't want to like overload my already, you know, big workload, but I know that I'm most certainly interested in one of the fellowships or being part of the society. So that's why, you know, I at least wanted to just throw out a question about, you know, would you even recommend that I even do this in the first place, right? Because you said it yourself, you know, you didn't, you opted out of MECOB.
Yeah, and I would say, I mean, you could still like apply apply to everything and just see what happens. I didn't even apply to MECOP because I was aerospace ride or die. And I was in the Aerospace Society. I worked on ORSAT, and I worked, my senior capstone was a rocket. And so I just kind of poured all of my energy into that, and it was really rewarding. But I know people have chosen MECOP for other reasons. And if you want to talk to someone who did MECOP while also doing, not at the same time, but then came back to do PSAS stuff, I have a couple people that I can connect you with, and I can put my email down below.
Okay, I really appreciate that. Yeah, because I'll reach out to you, follow up with that. Thank you.
Yeah.
I see Ashley's question. Are these more oriented toward physics and or engineering? I'm wondering because I'm a geology major, but wanting to go into astrogeology. No, it is not. The lovely thing about these fellowships and the lovely thing about the space industry is that it is all interdisciplinary. So we do need more than just engineers and scientists. We also need our policy wonks, we need our business people, we need our social media, we need our geologists, because especially with organizations like NASA or a lot of the new commercial satellite companies that are coming out and studying our planetary bodies that are floating around in space, like we need everyone at the table. And so yeah, don't let that stop you if this is something that you want to try, because there is definitely a place for you.
I can't fully speak towards the other fellowships, but I do know how they're all run because we all work together. But pretty much every single fellowship has way more engineers and scientists apply than non-engineers and scientists. And they do have quite a few jobs that are for non-engineers and scientists. And thus the likelihood, if you aren't an engineer or scientist, it's probably a better ratio. I'm not saying it definitely is. I'm just giving you a hint that it's probably a better ratio of your chances of getting in one of these fellowships if you are not engineering or scientist major. That doesn't mean to discourage engineers or scientists to not apply, because you definitely should. It's just that engineers and scientists are more likely to apply to a program like this. But there are quite a few like policy, natural sciences, engineering, journalism, and venture capitalism, and all of the above jobs in many of these fellowships.
Yes, and I will also add, because I know a couple of folks have experienced this as well, even in this current panel, but you can apply for more than, if you've gone through one of these fellowships, you can apply for a different one next year. Like it's not just like a one and done. Like Brooke Owens, you can apply for it, I think, at least twice. And Megan has actually applied to both Brooke Owens and Patti Grace Smith. Megan, did you want to speak to that a little bit for what that experience was like?
Yeah, sure. I can talk a little bit about, like, I guess, like, applying. So my first year, I guess it was 2021, so last year, I applied to the Brooke Owens Fellowship, and I didn't even get through phase one, but right after I found out that I didn't, well, I was still applying, so I applied to the Brooke Owens Fellowship and Patti Grace Smith Fellowship at the same exact time. So I do encourage students to also do that as well. So I found out that I didn't get into the Brooke Owens Fellowship, but I did get into Patti Grace Smith. I used that year to gain experience and work in industry for a bit, and then I reapplied to the Brooke Owens Fellowship and I got in. And I really think that having that internship experience through PGSS that was specifically for, you know, freshmen and sophomores at the time who don't have experience in the aerospace industry, I think it was super meaningful, and I'm glad that I did it. So yeah, I encourage everyone to apply for all of them if you can, if you have the capacity to do so.
All right. I'm going to go to panel questions, but please feel free to put more questions in the chat. But we have lots of time, so. Okay. I have such a tiny screen. Okay. Can you all please give a brief introduction about yourselves, which fellowship you participated in, except for Ryan, your host company at the time, and what you are up to now? I guess I'll start. So yeah, again, I was a 2021 Brookie. I applied my senior year knowing that I was going to do the plus one master's program. And I was at United Launch Alliance in Denver, Colorado. And what I am up to now, now I am in Maryland. I'm working at Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Lab. You might have heard a little bit in the news yesterday where we ran into an asteroid, it's a little thing, and I'm in the rotation program. Megan, your face is on my screen, so you can go next.
yes, hi everyone. So I'm Megan again. I participated in the Patti Grace Smith Fellowship in 2021, and I interned at Hermes Corporation, working on the structures team, and then 2022, I was Brooke Owens Fellow, and I worked for Amazon Prime Air in Seattle. In between those two fellowships, I worked at Northrop Grumman and Aviation Week. So now, fast forward to now, I am chilling. I'm in school and I am just focusing on school.
Okay, yeah. Teresa?
Yeah. Hello again, my name is Teresa. I use they, them pronouns. As mentioned earlier, I am a post-bac student, so I actually started with a bachelor's in arts and sculpture and metalwork. So that like unintentionally started the groundwork for going into engineering. And so I just slowly kind of worked my way through the grind of community college and then dual enrolling. And it took a few years to apply for fellowships for me just because my experience in learning how to talk about it was a little bit wonky. So as I got a little bit better about that, it was around the time that I applied for the Brooke Owens Fellowship, in addition to other fellowships in the past as well. And it took like a second attempt at applying to finally finish the application that I was able to get in, because the first time I like thought I could rely on my procrastination skills, but you really do need to kind of give yourself a second to represent yourself as authentically as possible. So I dropped out the first time I tried, but second time I got in, which was great. And so this past summer, I was in Boston for about 3 months working with Draper Labs. They're a company that siphoned off from MIT in around the 70s, so kind of during war times when they were like trying not to do work on missiles. And they are technically a nonprofit. And also half of their customer base is still military anyway. But that company was super great because it gave the most variety to being able to learn all sorts of different things. Like it was big enough that there were a lot of projects going on and you could be set to your team, but it was also small enough that you had the opportunity to kind of wear multiple hats and being part of local rocketry groups, Portland State Aerospace Society, and We in Space here in Portland, Oregon, that's a pace that I'm more used to. And so that was really, really great. So now I'm finishing up my last year of dual enrollment between community college and Portland State. And then I'll be in Portland State full-time and then applying for grad school and then just trying to get into summer internships from there.
Awesome. And I will do a quick plug for the Portland State Aerospace Society having its first general meeting of the term right after this on a different Zoom link. If you're interested in aerospace, you should attend that. And then Ryan, do you just want to give any other thoughts about the fellowship that you helped to found or anything about that?
Sure. Apply. Great. That's all I can say. It's absolutely incredible being able to create something that has helped so many people flourish. And when I tell you that it is a transformation when you go through these fellowships, it's a transformation. Like, I've seen now dozens upon dozens of students from start to end. And then only one year after the fellowship, like getting the most sought after jobs in industry, getting into their preferred graduate schools of choice. It is an incredible program and it completely changes your life. So definitely apply.
Cool, thank you. All right, any other questions? I see some coming in through chat. I just want to pause. You can also unmute if that's faster too.
I have a small one.
Yeah.
For the Zed Factor, I know a lot of these fellowships are paid internships. And as someone who is on disability, that is kind of a barrier sometimes. And so I was wondering if there are fellowships out there that have a part-time situation, or if it's something that would be able to be considered.
So in terms, to make sure I got your question right, you would be looking more for a part-time or just an internship that's open to people with disabilities, like Astro Access does?
Kind of both. So there's an income limit that you can make when you're on disability. And so that's something that I've been kind of curious about, like,
I see,
investigating with different groups.
I see. Well, so how Zed Factor works is that we do, depending on what you want to do, you have to have an internship. We are open to anyone, like if you define underrepresented as having a disability, then feel free to apply. So definite, and thank you, Teresa, for putting in the chat what I was talking about. Great program though, if you do have a disability, whatever it might be, that program is absolutely excellent. But with Zed Factor Fellowship, we do have a couple of interns who are part-time. For the most part, that if you make it to interviewing with host companies, we encourage you to bring that up with your host companies, because a lot of our companies are very, very open to working with you to do whatever makes the most sense for your current situation. So we've had we work with you too. So we've had students who work part-time while going to school still. We've had students who didn't have access to cars or transportations, and then we help them get access to transportation and work with the companies that way. So I say that shouldn't be a barrier to you applying, because all these fellowships, if they think you're awesome, then they want to help you in any way possible. Just so you know, they think everyone who applies is awesome. So they want to help everyone. Their resources are just limited. So as in the case of the Zed Factor Fellowship and every other one. But essentially, don't let that stop you from applying. There's a lot. I can't speak to the other fellowships because I think they all must be full-time internships. But at least for the Zed Factor Fellowship, there are opportunities for part-time, and it's extremely flexible. So don't let that stop you from applying.
Thank you.
Very good to know, thank you. Any other questions?
What's the general meeting about?
The general meeting that's at 7 is through the Portland State Aerospace Society. And so that's a weekly meeting in which the people who are part of the Aerospace Society, talk about the technical work that they're doing, and you can meet other people. And that's kind of like the best way to get started if you're interested in joining the Aerospace Society. You do not need to be a PSU student. You just need to be over the age of 16 and willing to work on some fun stuff. And then usually the orientation is either the second or third week of the PSU term, but you can still go to the first meeting. Or any meeting, actually. All right. Oh, yes. And general orientation is October 11th. Okay. Any other questions? Got about 12 minutes left. Okay. So I'm going to start with Megan for this one. What first sparked your interest in the space industry? How did you first hear about your fellowship and what motivated you to apply?
Yeah, sure. So to first talk about what sparked my interest in the space industry, growing up, I loved everything to do with science, technology, engineering, and math. But at first I wanted to be like a doctor. I didn't really want anything to do with engineering or space in general. But sophomore year of high school, my mom, she enrolled me in this program at the University of Alabama called Student Introduction to Engineering. And there I was immersed in all the disciplines of engineering. And on the last day, I got to visit the aerospace lab. And oh my gosh, that changed my life forever. I got to see a live wind tunnel demonstration and meet some of the students there and some of the professors. And I was like, I have to work in this industry. This is so cool. And so I did. I decided to major in aerospace when I got to college. And so how did I first hear about my fellowship and what motivated me to apply? I first heard about the fellowship through like a random Instagram page. Her name is Naya Butler Craig, or she goes by Astronaya on Instagram, but she's a PhD student at Georgia Tech. She's also a science communicator. She's also Black. And she's in a place where I aspire to be in a few years. And so I've just been following her. Yes, she is incredible. So I've just been following and watching her and seeing what she does. And she posted about the fellowship. And I was like, this fellowship, like the people, this is like for me. So I applied for it. And I guess I was just motivated to apply because I saw, you know, her posting it and encouraging for people like me to apply. So I did. And I'm glad that I did. Thank you for plugging Naya's Instagram.
No, I've been a super fan of Naya for like a really long time. Like she's such a super genius. It's ridiculous. Yeah. Well, I guess since I'm unmuted. Hello. let's see what first sparked it. I had an interest much later on in life, actually. I'd recently graduated with my first degree and you know, I'd been working in school and so much, I just wasn't making the connections that I air quote like should have been, you know, the things that like don't always get so actively discussed when you're an undergrad student because you're just like trying to make it through. So when I was just in between school, I was also going to art festivals, aka Burning Man, and one of my friends is like a master TIG welder and civil engineer, also graduated from PSU, oddly enough, but needed hands for building giant public art sculptures to put out on the playa. And he was like, you want to help? And I said, great. And that was where I first started getting into technical things. And he was also a huge space nerd. And so that sort of like stoked the fires a little bit, but like didn't get too obvious. Fast forward a few years later, I started kind of looking into school once I'd like tried to check out everything else off of my life list. And a friend of mine who had recently graduated from PSU as well, an astrophysicist major, slid me the link for Portland State Aerospace Society because her partner was actually part of PSAS for a number of years. And they were like, I think you will like this group. And I said, great. So then I showed up one sunny day in August of 2018, just kind of sat in on a meeting. I had no idea what was going on. I knew the pointy end went up and the flamey end went down. And that was about the extent of my knowledge, but it was okay because PSAS really embraces the fact that if you don't know anything, you'll know it eventually. And the only way to get experience in this industry is to kind of start somewhere. Because I know that it can be, it certainly was an insecurity for me, that if I wanted to get to something super technical and cool, I had to have this like ready and tangible experience, but also like I had to get that experience somewhere. And then I heard about the fellowship through, I think, Catie initially, because I'd start seeing it pop up on Slack and I was like, all right, this looks pretty cool. And I'd read through it. So I knew of it for a couple of years, but I just never like made the connection to actively apply. And then honestly, it was just once I like kind of quit the first time I tried applying, I gave myself more time. And that was really what I needed to finally do that final push.
Cool, thank you. I can also answer this, but I want to flip ahead since we were talking about space Twitter. This has myself and Teresa's information. And then Megan and Ryan, if you want to send me anything, I can also put it in here. Can't put emails in. I've never used Linktree before. So I put my email in the chat if people want to email me. But yeah, my Twitter is on there. Teresa's Twitter, if you want to follow us, we can get you into space Twitter. Yeah. And then before I answer that question too, does anyone have any other questions in the last 6 minutes? Anything? Ask us questions. Okay, I'm going to talk, but you can still put it in the chat. So yeah, I'm trying to remember what the question was. I got interested in the space industry. I grew up in North Florida. And if you know what's in Central Florida, it's a little place that launches rockets called Kennedy Space Center. So I got to see a space shuttle launch when I was in middle school. And I feel like if you see that when you're in middle school, like that's what you want to do. So I was really interested in doing aerospace. And I actually went to a couple different schools, first for aerospace, and then that didn't work out, and I found my way to PSU. So I do want to say, if you feel like you are a non-traditional student in any way, I am, Teresa is, we can definitely relate to that. And so I found my way to PSU for mechanical engineering, got involved in the Portland State Aerospace Society, which was like so awesome. They let me be lead mechanical engineer for the satellite after like 3 months for some reason. And it just gave me a lot of freedom to grow within aerospace. And then I heard about the fellowship because the Portland State Aerospace Society has a Slack workspace. And thank you. So we have a workspace, which if you join, then you'll get added to. And there's a jobs channel, so people can post different job opportunities within the aerospace industry, which is super helpful. And someone had posted the Brooke Owens Fellowship, and I actually didn't apply the first year. I just couldn't do it. But I used that year to think about what I wanted to apply and what I wanted to talk about the next year. And so then I applied and I got it. And I literally cried when I got the call from one of our exec members, Kayla Watson. And yeah, and then that just kind of really threw me into the industry. And I want to say just a really good example of like what the fellowships give you. So my mentor is Dan Dumbacher, who's the executive director of AIAA. He helped me when I was applying to jobs. And then at our event yesterday for DART, I just see someone like standing by himself in the dark, and it was Dan. And I go up to him and I'm talking to him, and he introduces me to someone who's very high up in the space industry, who just happened to be standing behind him. That was yesterday. So like the connections that you make are awesome. And we have like Slack channels with all the fellows, so you get a really great community. But also if you don't become a fellow, you still make connections with people who are also applying. We have a Slack channel for Brooke Owens Fellows applicants, which you can add yourself to. And meet other applicants. Also, if you post on like Twitter that you're applying, like you can meet other applicants. And also just fellows in general want to be your friend, even if you aren't a fellow. So you can reach out to any of us on social media and we can help you out with stuff. So, oh yeah, and there's Ask a Brookie. So you can like submit questions and brookies will answer them about different things. So Yeah. Okay, speed talking. 3 minutes. Any other questions? Okay, final thoughts from our other three panelists. We'll start with Ryan.
Putting me on the spot here, you miss 100% of the shots you don't take. So that just says apply and you never know what'll happen. And that should be life as well.
That's true. Just apply. Just do it. Like Nike.
The worst possible solution, the worst possible outcome is you spend a couple hours of your life writing an essay and you can't get that back. But the outcome of what that essay could become is more than you can imagine. So yeah. Anyone else? Thanks for having us. I have to run. So if you're interested in learning more, I put my email in the chat. So feel free to reach out to me, everyone. Have a great one.
Thanks, Ryan. And I'll also say that even if you do the essays, like Ryan was saying, like you'll spend some time doing essays, the stuff that you write, like I've used in like scholarship applications and stuff. So a lot of it you can easily transfer over. So even just doing it is really useful. Teresa, I see your face. You go.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, similar to what Ryan had said earlier, and also what a friend of mine said back in my organizing days, is that when you apply for something, the worst they can say is no. Like, if you like think you're underqualified, just apply anyway and see what happens. If they are open to giving you feedback when you ask for it back, if they tell you no, ask for it. Save all of your essays that you have ever written in some folder somewhere, because chances are you can reuse it, you know, tweak it a little bit and have another pair of eyes on it.
Yeah. Exactly. All right. And then Megan, to round it out.
Yes. My final words are just apply. If you want to be a part of something amazing, where you can really, really just grow your passions larger than you can imagine yourself. And then you're going to forever be a part of this community, even if you know, you're a fellow or not. So yeah, I just think you should really apply. And if you have any questions about Brooke Owens, Patti Grace Smith, or just getting your start in aerospace in general, please let me know.
Awesome. All right. Thank you to Megan and Teresa and Ryan who left for joining us, and Rose for doing all the introductions. And yeah, reach out to any of us with our emails, Twitter, LinkedIn, whatever. Go join Portland State Aerospace Society, your local Air and Space Museum, whatever. And thank you all for coming. Bye, everyone.